Hej, her er Cecilie Maria. Tak fordi, at du er tunet ind på Local Distortion Podcast, en engelsk podcast, hvor jeg blandt andet skal tale lidt om min tid i Taras, og hvad jeg går og laver lige nu.
So my guest this week is Cecilie Maria, former lead singer and bassist of Danish rock band Taras. Now, you were in Taras for 5 years.
Yeah, I mean, actually, I used to think it was 4 years. I'm pretty sure the girls also think it's 4 years, but it is 5 years. And I know that because I was looking at my Facebook memories and realized I had like shared the Taras Facebook page 5 years ago.
Okay.
So yes. 5 years.
Five long years. Lots of memories, obviously. Lots of highlights.
Absolutely.
Can you tell me some of your personal highlights from playing with the band?
Well, there's an absolute highlight for me was playing our first ever arena show. We were opening for a Danish band called DAD, and it was their 30th anniversary tour. And basically, they had this big tour final in a place called Bellerup Super Arena. Even just walking in for the setup and looking around, like realizing, oh my God, we're in an arena. I can't believe this. And really, it's like, it's one thing I kind of tell myself right now that cannot be the last arena play show I've ever played. Like, I need to do that again because that is
something else. And you need to headline as well.
eventually. I hope I don't have to wait 30 years for it, though. But
yeah,
not that these guys did.
No. So how big was the crowd in the arena?
I think the arena holds 15,000, and when we were on, obviously it was a bit early in the night, I think we were at a good 10,000 people.
That's really impressive. Yeah.
That
must have been incredible.
Absolutely. And the funny thing is I zone out. Yeah. I usually say when I play live a little bit, and I kind of can't remember what just happened. I know it sounds a bit crazy. I can like remember it in bits and flashes, sort of the way you would remember a dream or something. It's sort of, you see a flash here, see a flash there, but I can't really string together the full 30 minutes. This was like a 30 minute set.
So it just went really quick for you then?
It does. Like, it's like, especially when it's such a short set, right? And usually the opening sets are.
Yeah.
So when it's such a short set, you're halfway through the set and you realize, oh my God, like we have 3 songs left and I forgot to enjoy it, or I wasn't present in it because I was nervous, or because I was in my own head about what I was going to say between songs. And so it's really, I don't know, it's really important to get yourself into that mindset of just being awake and being aware of what you're doing, at least if you want to enjoy it, I think.
Definitely. Also, another thing you've mentioned to me previously is that you were on a national beer commercial.
Oh, yeah.
And that was with the same band as well, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was with the same band. That was kind of like, that was the beginning of 2014 for us, which was a really great year with some of the biggest experiences we've had. And actually the band was kind of having a bit of a break. The drummer was living actually in New York at the time. Well, before that happened, and then she came back home, and we were gonna start practicing again and stuff. But then we kind of asked to be in this beer commercial, having no idea. We basically just got asked to get, do you want to like try out and film for it and see how it goes? And of course, we said yeah, sure. And we were told to play. We're gonna play a DAD cover.
That's what they asked.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. And they asked us to play a DAD cover. And at the first filming, where it was just like a trial thing to see if they could use us, I started, you know, I kind of asked the person doing it, like, does it have anything to do with DAD? Because I know it's like it's their 30th anniversary this year, and I know that they're like Takrok, that's the name of the sub brand of the beer that we were in a commercial for, basically.
Yeah.
And I know that they're a Takrok band this year, and she's like, no, we just wanna hear you play and see you play, and like it has nothing to do with them whatsoever. And then when we came out, we got picked for the commercial, and we're really excited. And it kind of also forced us to just like get into the rehearsal room again and like pick it up where we left off. So we came out with all our stuff to film this commercial, and they told us, okay, so now we're going to set up your gear, and you're going to play the song 5 or 6 times, and then the idea is going to come, and they're going to play the song with you. We just laughed like, very funny.
So is this was obviously prior to the arena?
Yeah, that's like
stuff.
This is like a year before.
So was that the first time you met them?
Yeah, it was.
Wow.
And, you know, we had no idea, and we're like, yeah, haha, so funny. And I told one of them, but you're joking, right? No, we're not joking. And then we got really worried. We were like, couldn't you have told us that we could have practiced a bit more? Oh, this is going to go so wrong. But it went really well. And yeah, it must have, because we kind of got asked to come and play with them again. And we played a handful of gigs with them over the course of the year, one of them in London.
Yes. Where was that gig again? What venue?
It was in the garage in Islington.
Yes.
Yeah. And it was kind of funny because DAD is a band that in Denmark plays, you know, capacities of 5,000 people and up.
Yeah.
And the garage in Islington, you probably know that, is 700 cap or something like that.
Yeah, it's not the biggest venue we have.
So no. it was a very different experience also to get to see the show afterwards and like see them at such a small venue and to be a part of that. And it was actually the first gig we played after we'd been on a bit of a break. So,
wow, what a comeback gig.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, was that your first time in England, or had you been to London before?
I mean, I think all of us have been to London a few times before, been to London 4 or 5 times or something like that. Tara's never played in London before. I played in London once long, long time ago. So we actually, we made a bit of a trip out of it and kind of stayed. And
so how long did you stay for?
Stayed for 4 days. And we had like a really nice hotel for the first night after the gig that wasn't paid by us, obviously. So we had to kind of check out of that hotel and move into a hotel that we could afford to live in.
Yeah, London prices are very expensive. So I also found on YouTube you did an interview when you were here in London.
Yeah.
For I think it's some sort of Danish music channel where they were interviewing you in a taxi. Did you do any more interviews or anything while you were here?
Oh, we actually did. We did an interview with a British rock radio. No, we ran into this guy who was there to interview DAD.
Oh, okay.
And then he kind of like swift us off after the show, and we went to a pub nearby, which closed at 1 a.m., which was really weird to a Danish person, but apparently really normal.
that's only a recent thing in the last couple of years.
Yeah,
they did used to obviously be open all night, but there was issues.
Yeah. But we did manage to like get another interview in while we were there, and it wasn't even planned. So that was kind of cool.
So would you like to come back to England in the future and play some more shows?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think in terms of places to... I don't think the UK is easiest place to tour for foreign bands or for UK
not.
Bands. No, exactly.
Even for any bands, it's not...
I don't think it's the easiest place to tour. And I think that in part has to do with so many people want to do it so they can say that they did it. Like the UK is a pretty important market.
Yeah, definitely.
So people really want to, it's kind of like US, right? We also, like as Europeans, jump through a lot of hoops to kind of come to the US and play. And it's not always it's not always necessarily the most pleasant experiences. And a lot of money and a lot of work, time goes into it, where you could have set up a tour back home and, you know, stayed in Denmark or whatever. And it would have been easier and the pay would have been better and the accommodation and like general hospitality might also have been better. Don't take this the wrong way.
But, yes.
But I haven't toured a lot in the UK, so I don't know. I just know what my friends tell me who have. And it's like, yeah, okay, when we've been on our UK leg of the tour, we can't wait to go back to Germany.
And I'm not surprised.
Yeah, that has nothing to do with the crowd or anything. That's just the circumstances, like the things that go on backstage.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
That are just harder to deal with when you go to a market that's like very, like the German market is great. It's one of the most important markets. So I'm not underplaying that. There is this thing about the UK and the US for musicians. Like we really want to do it.
It's perception as well at the end of the day. Yeah. If someone sees you playing over there in those countries to someone who's been following you as a fan to see you doing that, that obviously makes them assume that, oh, you must be doing pretty well for yourselves then.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and that's the thing, right? And I think that perception is still live and well.
Yes. Your time in the band, you released one EP and two double singles.
Yeah.
Also, you did a video for Sexy Back, a Justin Timberlake cover. I was going to say Bieber then.
Yeah, I was just about to say.
Why would I say?
Yeah, no.
I talk about Justin Bieber so much on this podcast. It's surprising. I will get into that later, but a lot of people bring him up that I interview, which is, yeah. But no, Sexy Back, Justin Timberlake.
Yeah.
Yes. So you did a cover of that song. How did that happen? And why did you choose that as a song to do a video for?
We kind of, once we had to start playing again, after what happened when we went on a break, before all of this 2014 madness happened, we were kind of, as I said, on a bit of a break for like 6 months or something. And once the band got back together, we kind of decided to like toss everything and start completely fresh and like write new material. And it was going to be great. And we even talked about renaming the band. And it was like, it's like, we thought, oh, this is great. This is like our chance to like rebrand or whatever, you know, to kind of try something else out. Maybe not something else in terms of style, but, you know, kind of start fresh. And then we had done that, and 2 weeks went by, and we were still like writing our first new song and discussing, oh, what are we going to call the band? and then we got asked if we wanted to go to London with the ADs. So it's like we kind of had to. So obviously we picked up a lot of the stuff we already had. And we also started talking about, oh my God, should we do a cover? And right now I'm thinking, I'm not sure if we had the cover ready for that gig, but there's definitely a demand for shows where, and if it was this one or shows after, but there's definitely, we had to play shows where we couldn't fill up the entire time. So we thought, okay, let's do a cover. And we had various suggestions. And I don't know why we kind of landed on this. I guess we just thought it would be cool. And I thought that we felt like that the sort of riff would kind of work as a guitar riff and would kind of be fit into our vibe pretty well.
I think it definitely does. Yeah. I think you definitely pulled it off and made it your own. And I don't think it's probably, well, it maybe has been done, but not to my knowledge anyway, that it's been done in such a different style, like a heavier style anyway. So you didn't phone Justin Timberlake up and say, oh, can we use your song?
This is a sensitive subject.
Okay. You didn't sell it though, did you?
No, not at all.
Well, that,
and we also don't monetize the videos. But I think back then I didn't know that it was going to be a problem. It might be a problem. It hasn't become a problem yet, thank God. But no. I think
as long as you're not making money off of it in any way, then it's fine.
You'd think, but that's not actually the case. Yeah, really. I don't know if anyone bothers to do anything about it. I think it would be a shame. I think it works. I think it only...
I think it only helps the artist.
It broadens the audience to the song. Yeah, but I mean, I don't know that you feel like...
It's an old song as well.
Yeah.
So it's not like his brand new song that you've covered. So I wouldn't worry about it. I'm sure there's plenty of other cover videos that people do of his songs.
Yeah,
that are on
probably.
YouTube. So yours is just one of many. It's probably the best one, I would say.
Thank you.
Yes.
I mean, I think that's the thing, right? Like, as I said, knowing what I know now, I don't think I'd ever do that again. But
it's a very tricky thing to do.
Yeah, it's sort of
like when you're like a well-established band. Obviously, it's kind of different when you're just someone picking up a guitar and sitting in front of a camera and doing it. I think that's kind of different.
Yeah.
It's a tricky subject.
We'll see if there comes a takedown notice, takedown request
on it. Maybe if people like that cover, no one's going to flag it, so I wouldn't worry about it. Just messaged him over Facebook and just be like, look, I really love this song. I've done this tribute cover song for you. Yeah, please don't sue me. Can I play with you live sometime? That would be awesome. Thank you. Apparently he's a really nice guy, so it should be fine. Anyway, moving on. What is your favourite song from your time in the band? I'm sure you have many, but if you could pick just one.
You know, I think for me, I'm always very critical of my own work. So it's always a bit hard for me. I actually don't listen to my own music a lot. Can't really stand it. I know that sounds...
So you're kind of like an actor, in a way, who won't watch their own movies.
I mean, I definitely, you know, I'm not one to... And I don't know if that's a bad thing, but I'm not one to, like, buck my new friends, like, oh, my God, listen to what my band just did. And I kind of let it, you know?
Yeah.
I do my best to try and... Of course, I use social media, and so it's not like I completely keep it silent. I don't want anyone to hear it. It's not like that. I want everyone to hear it.
You just don't want to hear it.
Yeah.
just when you play it live, it's fine.
And in terms of playing live, I guess. I mean, for a long time, we've had Mass Destruction Man as our last song. I don't think that's necessarily because we felt like it was our best work, but it was like this kind of heavy and effective song to end off with. And I would probably say the one I'm happiest with is Fever, that came off of our first double single that came out in like 2014, something like that. I think that's probably the song I'm happiest with.
So what are you happy about that song? Just the general...
I think it has a great vibe. It kind of... Yeah. When we wrote it and I wrote the lyrics, I was kind of in this 2014 mindset. We'd just come off the summer of our lives, like the summer of doing huge shows, and there's all this media hype that came with it, and I felt unstoppable. I felt like this is not gonna, like, I want this summer to never end, and I want to capture that in a song.
Yeah.
And that's what I feel like it means to me. I don't know if that comes through to other people, but that's okay. Like, that's what that song meant to me. And
yeah,
I think that's
really good, yeah.
Yeah, and that's why I feel so attached to it. I'm also quite happy with my vocals on it, which rarely happens. So I think that goes back to that, like, nitpicking yourself and not being happy with what you did. So when you actually do something that you're happy with, it's something else, you know?
Yeah,
it stands out.
So where can listeners check out Taurus? Because they are still going.
Yeah, absolutely. Actually, the girls are working on an album now. So
okay.
I'm really excited to see.
Have you been replaced already? Or
I have been replaced.
Oh, okay. So for those of you who don't know, Taurus are a three-piece,
yep,
all girls, which,
yes,
some would say would be even better. Girl power. So can you tell us all their social media links so people can go and check them out?
The band's YouTube channel is called Taras DK, DK as in short for Denmark. So Taras DK, TARASDK. And the Facebook page is facebook.com/itstaras, so ITS and then Taras again. So ITS Taras. And I think that would be like your two first stops. There's also an Instagram, it's Taras too. Not two, it's Taras.
Okay, just Taras.
Yeah, I think so. It's Taras, ITS.
Okay. Awesome. And also, if the girls are listening, I'd love to have them on the podcast sometime. And
yeah, I'll let them know.
they can promote their new album. And yeah, that'll be awesome.
I'll let them know for sure.
Yes, definitely.
I hope they'll listen to it, but we'll see.
Well, they're probably so busy recording the album, but
yeah. I think they are.
Awesome. I look forward to hearing it. So now we're going to play a song from your time in the band. Would you like to introduce it for us?
Absolutely. This is a song about the time of my life, at least as a musician, the time of my life as a musician, and it's called Fever.
You've recently moved from Copenhagen to New York, and you're doing a master's degree in music business at NYU in New York City.
Yeah.
How did you decide that is what you wanted to do and to leave the band and study music instead? A pretty successful band by the sounds of it.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't an easy decision, and I think I might have left before if there weren't so many great things happening that like kept me where I was, without it sounding too out there. I think we as human beings, we make a lot of decisions based off of fear and wanting to feel safe and wanting to feel like we can predict what tomorrow is going to be like, even though that's insane to think that you could do that.
Yeah.
But we kind of, that's how we live our lives. I just wish that people would make more decisions off of, you know, based on passion and
impulse.
Yeah. Like, and I'm not, honestly, I'm not a very impulsive person myself. Like, it took me 5 years to finally move and like do something about it. And I thought I'd kind of practice what I preach for a change and do something. And I felt like I've always wanted to kind of live abroad and try my, you know, test myself in one of the world's greatest music cities.
Yeah, definitely.
And I've always wanted to do that. And I could just, you know, the clock was ticking. And I always thought, okay, if I go abroad and I study and I go into a good program, then I actually have a chance of making a life work somewhere else and kind of having, you know, especially when you want to go to the US, you kind of, you know, you need a good reason to go. And not to downplay the importance of or the importance of the program I got into, because it's completely amazing. But just to say that that's like backing up, that's like the overall, that was the motivation to do it, like just wanting to do something and find out if there's more. Like I feel like there's more out there, there's more world to be seen and more cultures to be experienced, and I wanted to try that out and not just go around and talk about it and think about it, but actually do something about it. And when it came to actually finding a place, I felt like I found myself really drawn towards New York. I can't really explain why, other than in the pit of my stomach, that's what felt right. Like,
I'd say you definitely picked the best place to go. Just culture-wise, just New York is just incredible.
I've definitely thought about staying in Europe for many obvious reasons. It would have been easier. Like, I don't know if going to London would have been easier now, or at least in a couple of years. it might not be as easy as it used to be. Yeah. But hashtag politics.
Yes.
but it would definitely have been easier to stay in Europe. But
like you said, you didn't want to play it safe, did you? You want to be taken out of your comfort zone.
Exactly. And like out of the things I considered, New York City was what got me most excited. And then when I kind of did some research and I found out about New York University and this particular program, I felt even more drawn to it. Like, this looks amazing and it sounds amazing and it's at an amazing school. I found out it was an amazing school. I'm going to be completely honest that I wasn't quite aware when I decided to apply how big of a deal it was.
Yeah.
And as I was in the process of applying, I realized, oh, okay, this is like top tier school, top tier university. And then I got really scared. I was like, I don't know if I can get in, but I luckily I did. and it worked out. And I'm so thrilled, and I'm so, honestly, I'm proud. I've been preparing to do this for the last year and a half, and somehow I've made it work, and that's amazing.
Yeah, that is. Yeah, it must be such a culture shock as well, because
it is.
How are you just getting on in the city? Because you're in.
I'm on the Upper West Side. I'm on Manhattan.
Okay. Yeah. How is that like, just living there?
I will not lie, the first 2 weeks were extremely overwhelming. And I think I also, the day I landed late at night on the 30th and on the 31st of August, and on the 31st of August, I had to start orientation at school. Yeah. I hadn't really planned that all that well. So I kind of came, you know, jet-lagged, froggy to the first couple of orientations. I was overwhelmed at first because, you know, it's a huge city. There are more people in New York that are in the country that I came from. Like, it just seems so, it's big and it's busy. Like, I used to think that I worked hard in Copenhagen, and I'm like, no, you didn't. not by New York standards, at least. It's just, it's a completely different game and it's a different vibe. But that's what I came for. Like, that's...
Yeah.
So that's also really exciting. Like, I came for that. That's what I'm here for. Like, I'm here to... Honestly, like, I'm here to compete. And if it doesn't work out, I can... I will never not be in a... I will never be in a situation where I can say that I did not try.
Yeah. And I'm sure you won't regret it because... You still had the experience at the end of the day.
Yeah, and human beings are extremely good at after rationalizing their own their own decisions, right? So you know, even if I should regret it, I never will because there's a mechanism in my brain that stops that, won't let that happen. Luckily, that's a good thing. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm just saying it's of course I'm not going to regret it. Like, I've definitely proved my own capacity to myself already just in being here.
Yeah.
And then everything from here is just icing on the cake. But I like icing, so I'm going to have a lot of it.
New York style icing.
Yeah.
What do your classes involve at the moment?
So,
are you still in orientation, or are you actually in proper classes?
I'm in class now, and what am I doing? I'm doing law in the music industry and practices and principles of the music industry. I'm doing this class, my elective this semester, is something called Music Innovation and Social Change, and I'm particularly excited about that. It's this class that's really focused on how music can help drive social change and how music influences human behavior and how when we innovate, not just in the music industry, but in other industries as well, how can we always have like a social layer to what we do? And that's something that really speaks to me. So I'm really excited about that. And I'm excited about the other classes too. And it's just... I mean, I thought I knew a lot about the industry. Maybe I did, but it's still
now. There's a lot really, you didn't know.
Yeah, and or like, you know, I might have an idea of the general directions that things are moving in, but like understanding the basic math of how much do we make on our albums? How much use did we use to? How much did we use to make? Is that how I say? Did we used to? Anyway, how much did we used to make versus how much should we make now? And like not just talking about it, but like seeing the numbers, being able to do the math. I think that's going to come in handy. Like it's definitely already, even though it's only been a couple of weeks, it's already kind of influencing my my viewpoints and my perceptions about the industry are kind of being challenged right now, and I think that's really cool. And of course, like, it's also just a different industry. Like, it's, you can't compare the Danish music industry to the American music industry, or, you know, even the American music industry is very different to the European music industry. So there are those things as well. I've landed in a new place and they have different rules, and luckily I have exceptional help to understand those rules.
So your course is 2 years.
Yeah.
What would you like to achieve maybe whilst you're studying and just generally in New York? What would you like to achieve in your time there?
Right now, my focus is very much like short term. It's important to me to get out there, quote unquote. I'm doing air quotes. Obviously, people are not going to be able to see that. I'm really focused on getting out there right now and to get playing again and, you know, not just talk about music, which I do a lot of in school, but actually make music. And my long-term goals right now are very much all focused on being a full-time artist and songwriter. Like, that's really what I want to do. It's also something that is, I mean, it's always been hard, but it might be even harder now, especially if you're an upcoming or like middle layer musician. You kind of need to be, you said Justin Bieber earlier, Bieber, Beyonce, you know, whatnot, you name them. There's like a gap that's getting wider and wider and wider between That's
why this podcast has been invented.
Yeah.
To bridge that gap from the people starting out.
And luckily a lot of people see that. It's unfortunate that it's there, but a lot of people see it happening and a lot of people are trying to tackle it.
Yes. But that also creates opportunity, I'd like to think. Certain bands will come along and they will change the industry and they will change how certain things are run and done. And, you know, maybe this podcast can eventually have a tiny amount of impact on that. And
yeah,
that's what I'm trying to achieve, is to build a community of bands that are starting out and that maybe are just knocking on the door of radio management and record deals. But I'd like to be a part of that, build a community of bands and fans that are all just in one place. And that's easy for fans to discover and easy for bands to discover other artists as well that maybe they'd want to play with, or generally make a new community that is sorely needed, I think.
Mm.
Especially in England anyway.
Absolutely.
What I like about this is that I can branch out and I can talk to people in other countries. Obviously, you'll be bringing your own section of fans to listen to this podcast. And maybe they'll hang around. Maybe they'll check out some of the other interviews that I've done with other bands that they haven't heard of. And maybe some listeners are already in bands back in Denmark.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they'll want to come on the show. Maybe, obviously, Taurus, obviously. we'll have to get them on.
And I'll love you for it. I'm sure they'll be happy too.
Yeah, and that's that's the whole point of this. It's to bring people together. It's to give artists and musicians a voice and have a platform where they can sort of say it how it is and tell people the successes that come with that. That's my own personal goal. I just do this as a hobby, and I said if I could do one podcast a month, I'd be happy with that. And I'm currently doing 3 to 4 podcasts a month, and I'm now having bands also come to the studio where I record the podcast, and we're doing acoustic sessions which I'm recording them live, doing some videoing for that obviously as well. There's many other things that I'm going to branch off into, which I won't go into just yet because they're all in the pipeline.
Yeah.
But yeah. Hopefully it's going to generally grow and change into something. I would urge people to stick around because
absolutely,
you never know who you're going to find. I don't know who I'm going to find. And that's the great thing about it, is that I find bands that I haven't heard of. There is some great music out there. It just needs to be heard. And that's what this platform is all about. So now we're going to talk about guilty pleasures.
Yeah. So
that's songs or artists that you might be a little embarrassed to admit that you like, but you just love it. Like a little bit of cheese, maybe.
I'm super into, I love drag queens. And every now and then some of them put out horrible music, but I can't help it. I like it.
I don't know if you've heard of Jeffree Star.
I don't. Actually, I haven't listened to Jeffree Star's music. I've seen a lot of pictures.
My sister was like obsessed.
Okay, maybe I should check it out.
With Jeffree Star. Funny story, actually. He actually called my house phone once when I was with my parents, because my sister used to live at home. And my sister had given him the house phone number. And she was like, oh, please call me. And and he called the house.
That's amazing.
And they were just chatting on the phone, and she obviously met him at a local gig that he played, because even he toured in England, which is hilarious. And she's got all pictures where she met him, and but I just found it hilarious that Jeffree Star called my mum and dad's house one day.
Oh, that's amazing. No.
But anyway, back to your guilty pleasures.
I mean, there are also several Disney songs that I enjoy a lot.
Disney is good. What kind of
actually
songs?
One of my favorite Disney songs, I like the stuff from The Lion King written by Elton John. I like the stuff from Tarzan written by Phil Collins.
They are incredible songs
Tarzan. Right,
they were all Phil Collins, weren't they, the Tarzan soundtrack?
So there are definitely things there. Again, I don't know, you know, I actually have this kind of hidden dream that, you know, one day from now, when nobody wants to see me live anymore, maybe I can write Disney songs. Maybe one day.
Yeah, wow.
As, that... as a retirement
maybe,
plan.
For the next Frozen film, you could do the soundtrack, yeah. Maybe.
Oh, that would be cool.
Yeah.
Disney can just call me.
Yeah. Disney, if you're listening.
Yeah.
Which you probably are, because you have eyes and ears everywhere. Do you have any advice for aspiring musicians who are maybe just starting out, or who are just musicians at the moment in general?
I mean, this is always tough, right? I feel like I could still use a lot of advice myself. I think that's in part why I...
But that's kind of good advice, saying yeah. That is that always be open to
yeah
more advice.
I would say, and it is one thing I'm struggling with myself, and that's why I think I can say it, is that you need to always remember to have fun with what you're doing. I mean, I've definitely had, and maybe I'm still going through actually, periods of time where I'm not really enjoying myself unless stuff works out. You know, obviously I can sit here and say, oh, that time I played an arena show, I was really happy and I was having fun. Oh, that time I was in a national beer commercial, ooh, that was so much fun. You know, having success is always fun.
Yes, and, I'm sure it is.
but everyone is going to go through, like, even, I think even the biggest of stars in this world are going to go through times where there's a lot of pressure to what are you going to do next. And what I'm trying to say is try and remember that you're doing what you're enjoying, even when it seems like it's not going to work out. Because, and even if you're in times and in a period where, oh, there are not a lot of shows to look forward to and there's not a lot of media interest right now, just try and remember to have fun with it anyway. Yeah. I think that's something that can help tremendously. Also, like, in just making better music. If yeah. you forget that it has to be fun and start worrying about, that's one thing I'm struggling with right now, is, oh, is this current enough? Oh, is this, this is so old school. Oh, I can't do that because people are not going to like it, or it's not modern, or it's not. And if you let that kind of, those kinds of thoughts get to you, then it's real easy to start writing a song and then just stop yourself before you even written the chorus, because you keep holding what you're doing up to these impossible standards right from the get-go.
Yeah, definitely.
Instead of just creating something and be happy that you're able, like, there's so many people, when you tell them that you play an instrument, I play two instruments and I sing, when you tell them that you do that, it's like, oh, I wish I could play the guitar. I wish I could play the bass. You will tell me, right? And I wish I could play the bass. Oh, that'd be so cool. And, like, just remember that you're already doing something that people wish that they could
yeah,
do.
Yeah. Yeah, and I can back that up, because obviously a little insider, like, you used to kind of teach me bass when I tried to play bass a good couple of years ago now. And yeah, you kind of helped me out with that at the time. Obviously, I'm currently not playing bass. I think, yeah, some people just need to remember that at the end of the day, like, playing guitar is, like, an awesome thing. Just don't waste your talent.
Yeah.
Don't just leave it aside and just not pick it up. Because if you've got the talent to play it, then some people out there would love to do that.
Exactly.
And yeah, I would encourage people to learn if that's what they want to do. But some people who have that just raw talent to pick up instruments and make music, you know, that's a gift, and you should make the most of that.
And if you're hung up on how are people going to receive this, or how, you know, if it becomes business all of a sudden and it's all business and no fun, then you're not going to put out, you know, you're not going to make great music. At least that's my experience. That's speaking from... That's what I see right now, that I tend to stop myself in the process because I don't like what I'm doing. And the only reason I don't like what I'm doing, you know, it's coming from me.
Yeah.
The only reason I don't like it is because I'm constantly questioning, where is it going to take me in my career? That's just not a healthy mindset to be in.
No.
When you're trying to create stuff.
No, definitely not. No. But I'm sure you'll get out of that little rut, and I think you're producing some demos at the moment.
Absolutely. That's the thing right now.
Yeah, and one of your demos is currently up on SoundCloud, but you said you've been taking it on and off.
I've been toggling that little private, public, yeah. private, public. Like, every now and then, depending on what state of mind, to be honest. But I've decided now, until I've most of done that I feel is finished, now I'm doing air quotes again, then I'm probably going to, you know, until then, I'm going to leave it up there. So if people want to check it out, it's going to be there.
Okay. Shall we play a little teaser of it on the podcast?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Would you like to introduce the little teaser demo for us?
Oh, yeah. This is a song I wrote together with a great friend of mine called Camilla. It's really an attempt of making sort of an anthem for the vibe I want to get into. And I really want to try and give my two cents on how glam rock will sound in 2017 and onwards. this is my idea of it. Co-written with Kim de Burgwell, and on guitars it's Dennis Post, and the rest is made by me.
Now we've come to the end of the show. Where can everyone follow you on social media?
I will encourage people to go to ceciliemaria.com, and right now it redirects to my Facebook page and you can follow me there.
You obviously have SoundCloud as well.
Yeah, exactly. soundcloud.com/Cecilie-Maria. I am on Instagram at Cecilie_Maria. I think those are the best places right now to get a hold of me.
So everyone can follow your journey in New York and hopefully eventually some band-related stuff.
Oh, yeah. I mean, if anyone's near, you know, in New York and want to try and do some modern-day glam rock with me, I'm all ears.
You can now support Local Distortion on Patreon by donating as little as 1p, that's 1 penny, or would you say 1 euro? No, that's like a pound, isn't it?
Yeah.
what's like the equivalent of
a penny? It's a euro cent, right?
Yeah, maybe.
Cent.
1 euro cent a month for the European listeners. Also, check out the page for rewards I offer for higher donators who support the podcast. So that's patreon.com/localdistortionpodcast. You can join the Local Distortion community on Facebook. That's facebook.com/localdistortionpodcast. I'm also on Twitter, which, yeah, you just kind of have to be these days. Follow me on Twitter at Dan L Distortion. And subscribe to the Local Distortion Podcast YouTube channel for more interviews, live performances from the shows I attend. And also check out Undiscovered Sessions on the Local Distortion YouTube channel, which is the stripped back acoustic performances filmed and recorded in the podcast studio. Thank you to my guest, Cecilie Maria.
Thank you for having me.
It's been really fun catching up with you. And hopefully, maybe in a year's time, we'll do a catch-up video. Maybe not a video, but like another interview. And maybe you'll have some more stuff to show us.
That's the plan.
Yes, that is the plan. I'll hold you to that. And thank you to everyone for listening. And that's it.
No, that's at the beginning. Oh, now we have to start over.
Oh, no. No one clapped. Oh.